101. Good morning, Mark Brewer here. It is 10 o'clock high, and we have a very special guest in the studio this morning, the Lord of the Drums himself, Mr. Steve Negus. Welcome, Steve. How you doing?
I will be awake shortly, I'm sure. I'm working on it.
Good. Now, you've been on Indi 101 before, right? On the blues show? On
yes,
Wednesday
I have.
Show.
Yeah.
So, where are we going to start here, Steve? You've been a rock drumming mogul for many years, 30 plus years. When did the whole thing start? Your career in drumming, when did it all start?
Well, I guess I really got interested when I was about 10.
Okay.
So, I just started playing on the furniture and annoying everybody. Through high school, I used to get reprimanded for pounding on the desk.
Okay.
You know, drumming on the desk.
So that's where it all started. It started on like a school desk.
Yes, actually, somewhere around there, it started out as taking the living room furniture and making it into some sort of magical drum kit.
Okay. Now, what bands were you in your teenage and early 20s years? Let's start off with that.
That's going back. Well, I'm
making Steve Negus think this morning, everybody.
Yeah, you're really testing the gray matter now.
Was Flood the first big one?
Oh, that's that was actually Flood came along in '70s, mid '70s.
Okay.
So I was already in my 20s then.
Okay, but before
so
that,
in high school,
yeah,
my first band was called the X Factor.
Oh, I think Simon Cowell might have issues with that now, but
yeah, and we just played local gigs. It was, you know,
cool. What kind of music was it? Was it all covers?
At that point, it was, yeah, Beatles and Stones.
Okay, the good stuff.
Yeah. And then later on, I had a band called The Color of Time, and that was more the Jimi Hendrix and Cream and that kind of
more good
stuff. Yeah.
Okay.
A little bit more challenging.
So how did you make the transition between doing covers in the City of Hamilton area, whatever you were playing, like wherever you played, to going to this 30 plus year Canadian icon drummer guy? Like,
well, when I finished high school, I moved to Toronto and I actually worked for the Bank of Montreal as a management trainee. And
okay.
It took me a little while to figure out that's not really what I wanted to do.
Okay.
So at that time, I was actually playing six nights a week in a country band.
Country? Steve Negus playing country?
Well, yeah.
That's interesting.
Anything to play. You know, when you're young and enthusiastic, you play with anybody, anywhere, anytime.
Okay.
Know? So as long as you're playing, it was cool. So yeah, I was working in the bank 5 days a week and playing six in the country band.
Okay. How long did that last?
That was about 2 years, and then I quit that, and I joined a 50s rock and roll band called Bananas, which became one of the biggest show bands in Toronto at that time.
Okay.
And I did that for 2 years. We'll kind of accelerate through this.
Sure.
Then I heard Tower of Power. That changed my life. I wanted to play R&B stuff, so I quit Bananas and put together an R&B band called Shelter.
Okay.
Which was my band. And we did a whole summer up at Wasaga Beach at the Dardanella.
The Dard.
Yeah.
That's a great place.
That was
still is there, I think.
Yeah. Yeah. And after that summer, we disbanded. We broke up. The summer was just too much.
What else? What else happened after that?
After that, I did a quick stint with Dave Bendith.
Okay.
Who's now gone on to be sort of a New York heavyweight producer/engineer.
Okay.
And then I joined Grant Fullerton.
That name is very well known, of course.
Yeah, Fullerton Dam. Grant used to play with way back in the band called Stitch in Time and Lighthouse.
Yes, Lighthouse.
In one of the earlier versions of Lighthouse. And I played with him for 2 years, and then the Flood Boys were looking for a drummer, and they came in and saw me play at the club in Toronto and offered me the gig with Flood.
Okay.
So that's, we're up to mid-70s.
How long did that last with Flood?
I think it was, for me, it was just about a year and a half.
Okay.
Brian was in remission at that time. He had leukemia. Brian Pilling, one of the two Pilling brothers.
Alrighty.
He got sick, his remission broke down, and the band had to basically stop playing.
Okay.
So, and then the rhythm section, which was myself, Jimmy Crichton, and Peter Roshan, stayed together to actually form the early version of Saga, which was called Pockets.
Yes, I remember you telling me that name years ago.
Yeah, so that was 1977, and we spent 8 months in the old Phillips building in Toronto and in rehearsal, and we rehearsed like at least 8 hours a day, 6 days a week.
Now, was it Prague at that time?
There was no such thing as Prague.
You guys invented Prague, didn't you?
Well, no, but somebody
pretty close.
You know, we just play the music and leave everybody else to come up with the labels. So, you know, we used to call it medieval funk.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, because some of the stuff's got that medieval feel, and sure. My background, being sort of more on the R&B edge. Was the non-standard part of the progressive formula. So it gave everything sort of more of a funk groove than say Yes or King Crimson or...
That was more straightforward stuff.
Yeah, that was more coming from the British approach, which mm-hmm. was definitely not funky.
No.
You know? So that's really one of the things that really made a big difference in the Saga sound and groove.
Okay. Was your drumming?
Of course.
Yeah,
it's all about me.
Today is all about Steve Negus, everybody. So Pockets to Saga, when did that transformation occur?
Well, basically we were in phase one recording the first album as the band was coming together.
Okay.
So we were working with Paul Gross, who had also done work with Flood.
Okay.
And we pretty much had the first album finished, and we discovered that when we went to release it under Pockets, there was another band who already had the name, which was this R&B band from the States, related to Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
There was an affiliation there.
Yeah. So we weren't allowed to use the name, so then we just basically brainstormed with management and come up with a new name.
Interesting.
So there was no real transition, really, because we just changed the name and away we went.
It
was like, didn't seem to be a big deal.
Indi 101, there is Negus with the first track off his Dare to Dream project called Lust. And Steve, you want to maybe give me a little rundown on who's in that recording? I already know.
Well, I have to say, it's amazing that I can play that good this early in the morning.
Yeah, I was actually, when you came in this morning, I was saying, geez, no coffee, no nothing, and, you know, our Timmy's here at Mohawk is not open.
Yeah, Timmy's is not open, and I'm really upset.
So Steve's really pushing the envelope here. This is worse than, well, not worse, this is as challenging as playing the Rock Am Ring in Germany, right?
There you go, there you go.
So, who's on...
Players on the Negus album?
Yeah, well, Mark Severn.
Mark Severn, yes.
Played in that.
He did. Didn't he? Yeah.
The late, great Mark. Who is a very close friend of yours, right?
Absolutely. He died about 2 weeks after he finished that album.
Wow.
Was killed in a car accident coming down Highway 6. We miss him. But yeah, he played guitar on it. Also, Jimmy Gilmore from the late, great Saga. Mm-hmm.
Yes, Daryl. Daryl.
AKA Daryl.
Yep.
Played the keyboard part, and we did that over the net. I sent him a file of it, and he sent me a MIDI file back, and then I messed with the sound and his performance.
Did you edit his playing, actually?
I did, yeah.
Is that more of a creative thing, or is that didn't sound right, Daryl, and I'm just going to change it?
Yeah, that's a...
You don't need to comment, Steve.
Being the producer, I had a tendency to mess with everything.
Well, that's not a bad thing, though.
I did edit the performance just a bit, you know,
okay.
and I was working with a sound, because, I mean, basically, he did it in his small studio at home, and then I got the computer file, and I decided to tweak it a bit. you know.
Well, that's cool.
Well, his comment was, it's the best solo he's ever played.
So. Which you modified, so.
I also did that. He played piano on Dare to Dream 2, and I actually edited that as well.
That happens all the time, though.
Of course it does.
You know, you go into the studio, and the producer or, you know, a person involved in the project will modify things, and, you know.
Of course, yeah.
That's what a producer does.
Yeah, it's all about the song, so... I would even edit my own stuff if I felt it was necessary, and I probably have.
Who else is on that album, Steve?
Okay, Kenny McLaren also played guitar on just that one track, Lust.
Okay.
I did all the keyboard stuff except for the solos on that. Ian Nielsen played bass on that one.
And Ian's well known in the city.
Yeah.
Yes.
And who else did we have on that? I think that's basically, of course, Al Langley.
Yes, Aldous.
Sang on that, and we wrote this whole album over the internet.
What was that experience like, Steve? I know when you had the other studio over where you used to live, and we've been back and forth on radio for 5 or 6 years now, mostly internet, but what was that process like going back and forth? Al being in Thunder Bay, you being in Hamilton, and the whole collaboration going back and forth digitally on the internet. What was that experience like? Because you've always been a cutting-edge guy. You were the first drummer in the world to play Simmons drums. You were the first drummer in the world to really do a solo, the Briefcase, with Michael Sadler from Saga, which was cutting-edge. And I sold many stereo systems with that track. what's it like to engage in those cutting-edge things? Like, you're well-known for that as a drummer and as a producer now.
I've always embraced the technology. I think just having all those tools, anything is a tool. You know, it's something you can utilize to make your music better. I'm all for it. Drum machines, I've always loved them. I think drum machines are probably the biggest aid for drummers.
But that's in the pre-prod stages, right? Obviously, you're talking about, right?
Well, I just think for playing in time.
Okay.
You know, if you play to a machine, the machine doesn't lie if you speed up or slow down, which okay. A lot of drummers do.
Sure.
The machine doesn't. Okay. So it shows you where your strengths and weaknesses are.
Would that be like what we would call a click track now?
Yes.
Back then you would use a drum machine as a rhythm keeper?
Yes, I started using a click track in 1979.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
And actually it was there was a interim keyboard player in Saga around the time of Images of Twilight.
Okay.
And this, he shall remain nameless, but he had a tendency to blame everybody else for his own inadequacies. So at one point he said my timing was suspect.
Your timing?
My timing.
Hmm.
So I said, you so-and-so. I'm going to play this album to a click track just to show you that my timing is not suspect.
Yes.
So that's when I started using click track, and it's probably one of the best things I ever did. I've been using that ever since, and it's just a great tool because I can actually do the drums at the beginning.
Sure.
Or I can do the drums as the last thing that I do, which is what I did with Dare to Dream. I recorded all the other tracks first and then put
the drums. Is that a technique that you really like doing, or is it just how it fell into place?
Well, being the keyboard player and sometimes guitar player, mm-hmm. and doing everything else, I needed to have the tracks fleshed out before I could really play drums on it.
Okay.
Because as most drummers will tell you, it's really hard to sit down and play a song just on the drums because there's no melody.
Okay.
Right? So you can play all the parts, but they just don't feel right without having all this stuff has been done to a click track since 1979.
Would that be the first album? Saga's first album?
Second
album. Yeah, so the first album was freestyle. Then.
Straight off the floor, yeah.
Okay. Interesting. Now, talking about Saga albums for a minute, In Transit, which most people don't know, is actually the first ever rock CD ever released.
It was one of the first 5 CDs ever released, because we run this label in Germany called Deutsche Grammophon. It was the first rock CD ever released, and it was the first digital live album.
Now tell us that story, Steve. I've heard it many times. We've been friends for 5 or 6 years now, but tell us that story of the fridge, the recorder that they brought in
Oh, right.
to do that. It was the size of a fridge, wasn't it?
It was bigger.
Bigger than a fridge.
Yeah, it was huge. It was probably about 5-6 feet wide.
Okay.
And it was a huge, it looked like a typical tape machine of the old era.
Okay.
The old Studer machines.
Sure. The big ones. Yeah, the big massive ones.
And it was a 32-track Mitsubishi machine.
Back then was elite.
Yeah.
Elite, elite, elite.
Well, we recorded that in Germany and Denmark. And then when we came back to Canada to mix it, we had to fly a machine in from New York.
Okay.
And bring it into the studio here in Toronto. And it came with two technicians. These guys babied that machine to make sure it was running.
Okay.
You know.
Were they technicians and kind of gatekeepers as well?
They were pretty gnarly guys. You know,
yeah, you didn't play around with their toy.
They were geeksters.
Well, now, this album, In Transit, was it one location that it was recorded at? Or was it multiple?
It was Munich and three nights in Copenhagen.
Okay. Interesting stuff.
Yeah, I think probably most of it came from the Copenhagen show, just for the reason that we had three nights to get the sound together.
Okay.
So, yeah, every night it improves. When you move to a new venue, you start again.
Sure, you got mics pointing different ways and all that kind of stuff. And you actually remastered this too, didn't you?
I did.
And when did you remaster it? About 5 years ago?
It's longer than that now, I think about
2003. It says right here.
That's what I was going to say, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Cool. So I think we'll play. Go ahead, Steve.
Well, I was just going to say I remastered the entire Saga back catalog.
Right up until Trust, right? Back to the music. And we have Steve Negus in the studio, who is a Canadian icon, drumming icon.
There we go. I'm an icon.
You are. That must probably drive you nuts, right? You
know? I don't think about that stuff. I don't take it seriously.
A lot of people take you seriously, though.
Well, that's...
It's a whole different...
That's a different issue.
Yeah.
I hope they take me seriously. I mean, you know, this is... Otherwise, I just wasted 50 years of my life.
True. Now, okay, back to Dare to Dream. Well, let me back up for a second. You're working on new stuff as we speak.
I'm always working on new stuff, but I'm taking a different approach than I did to Dare to Dream.
Now, what's the motivation for that? Or changing your style, or changing, we were talking during the break actually
it's
about your writing style.
I can. Some of these things you just can't think about them. You just have to do what feels right.
Okay.
Now, when I started writing the music for Dare to Dream, I was doing keyboards and guitar parts, and as we mentioned earlier, that the last thing I recorded was the drums.
Sure.
And I did find, actually, because I had done that, there was a couple tunes that I would have liked to have just bumped the tempo just a bit, you know,
okay.
for the drumming stage of it. This time I've decided to take the approach of starting with the drums, so I've been in woodshed mode for a while, it's hard to say in the morning, for about 6 months. Maybe a little bit longer, where I'm just playing about 3 hours a day.
So you're homing your craft.
Yeah, and I just wanted to take it up another level. So
I can't imagine you taking it up another level, because I already find that the drumming is incredible to start with. But I guess, you know, you didn't get to where you are, right, by being lazy.
That's true.
You know, you've always been pushing yourself for years, right?
Absolutely.
You know.
There's some guys I've been listening to on the internet that are absolutely phenomenal drummers. Now, I'm learning from them. You always learn. This is the important thing, is the journey. So, you know, when you make music, it's all about the journey.
Okay.
Once you finish a project, then for me, it's done. I move on to what's next. You know, but the joy in making music is actually the process, whatever it is and wherever it is, of making music.
Okay.
So you do something, you enjoy it while you're doing it, and then you finish it and you move on to what's next. You know, that's all part of growing as an artist and a musician.
Sure.
So that's what's driving me at this point.
Now, we've spoken a lot about your past Saga experiences and touching on that. There's a point where you had creative control in that band. And then at a certain point, you lost that, right?
Yes, yeah.
whether how it happened, who cares, but you really didn't have as much input into some of the SOG material later in your career with Saga. And now you are in full control. You're in the driver's seat. How's that feel?
I like it.
Does it invigorate you? Does it make you feel that all those years that you've been working and maybe not so much at the end with Saga on the stuff that you really wanted to do, but now you have your own projects and you're actually accomplishing that. And some of the music on this album, Dare to Dream, was proposed Saga songs, right?
That's correct. Yeah.
Which they outright rejected.
I don't think they even listened to them, to be honest.
You gave them to them and they just
yeah
pitched in the garbage, which yeah I think is a real waste. But
well, I do too. That's why I had to make Dare to Dream. That my main motivation at that point was coming out of Saga, where I wasn't feeling satisfied creatively.
Yeah.
And I certainly wasn't feeling satisfied with the tracks I was doing in the studio because I was excluded from the writing process.
So you would just come in and they'd go drum this?
Yeah, and actually there was one album I said,
unbelievable,
because we used to go to LA to record.
Sure.
I said, just send me the tracks, I'll do them at home. I did them at home.
Really?
Yeah. Which was actually cool. That's when we really started to get into the process of shipping stuff over the internet. So
okay
files back and forth.
Interesting.
I did all my drums at home and just sent them to LA because I didn't want to go there.
Now, No Heaven, No Hell, a track off of Dare to Dream. Was that an old song that you originally gave to the Crichtons?
No,
or is this
no,
something you came up with after?
That was something that came a little bit later on in the writing process for the Dare to Dream.
Now, did you and Mark work on that one? Mark Seven?
Mark worked on all the stuff.
Okay. All
yeah
right.
Basically, what I did is when I sketched everything out, I
sure
put guitar parts down, or I would generate electronic guitar parts just to get the ideas across.
Okay.
Then what I did is I went into the Jam House, which was a rehearsal place.
Downtown Hamilton.
Downtown. And we set up Mark, and I recorded my drums there too. I set up like 20 mics on my kit and just
big
used
sounding
the whole
kit,
room,
yes,
you know, which was very cool. But Mark and I would spend days just working on guitar parts for the whole album. So we would go through the process and try stuff. And I think it's some of Mark's best work ever. I think he was really starting to blossom as a player. Not just from a technical standpoint, because basically what everybody had done with Mark over the years is say,
sure,
play like this guy.
Oh,
you know,
okay,
play like Steve Vai, play like Satriani, play like somebody, you know. And I said to him, no, just play.
Be yourself.
And he actually...
Did that surprise him?
It did.
It really?
Did. And it actually took him back a bit, so he had to sort of rethink, because nobody had ever said that to him.
I'm surprised, actually, but...
I'm not.
Well, no, you know, right? You've been in the industry so long, Steve. I mean, you know...
I just find that the people are hankering for labels.
Really?
You know, they want to hang a label on everything.
Instead of just being who you are.
Yeah, and it's really hard. I mean, in anything in the arts, it's sometimes very difficult to put a label on something.
Okay.
You know, especially if it's innovative and new and got a different slant or a different approach. But that's all part of us trying to fit everything into the little box so we can package it.
Okay.
You know?
Now, No Heaven, No Hell, is this actually an atheist song? I just want to ask you right off the top, because the thing starts out, No Heaven, No Hell. Was it written just to say that there's something more than religion in life, that it's not so much about religion, or can you touch on that one for me, man?
Okay. I didn't write the lyrics for this. Al wrote the lyrics.
Al?
I believe that what he's saying is, I mean, if you look at it, it's just everything exists, and you make of it what you will.
So it's not really anything to do with anything. It's to do with living life.
Yeah, I mean,
and not worrying about if there's
there's just
yeah
water flowing, right?
Okay.
So it's really more about the fact that there's a natural course of events, and if you want to again package it and put it in a Bible or put it in a book, then you can categorize it and you can paint painted blue. You could do what you want. But again, you're basically packaging an idea, which doesn't work. Right?
Okay. That makes sense, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I don't think it's necessarily about, you know, is there God? We didn't really want to go there.
No, of course not.
But
some people might interpret it as that. I know you haven't. I know Al hasn't. Okay, you both haven't. But, you know, because the song starts out, there's no heaven, no hell. You know, that I just wanted to touch on that quickly because some people listening in Hamilton
might. That's right. We wanted to upset all the Catholics. We really did.
From the CD Dare to Dream, there's no heaven, no hell. That is Negus, Indi 101. And we have Steve Negus in the studio sitting 3 feet across from me.
Here I is, right here.
Here you are. Yes. Now, we were talking during when we were playing the song, where we were talking about Mark and how when you and Mark collaborated on the album and you just told him to be himself and play, that actually happened to you with Rupert Hine, right? Back
yes.
in the 80s?
Yeah, it did. I went to England to record an album with Chris de Burgh.
The huge Chris de Burgh album.
The infamous Chris de Burgh. Krusty Bird, as we used to call it.
Krusty Bird. I'm finding all kinds of new stuff about it with you, Steve. I've known you about 5-6 years now, and I've never heard you say that one. Krusty Bird. So, Rupert Hine and Chris asked you to come to England and drum on the album, and it so happens that that huge, huge song, Don't Pay the Ferryman, was one of them. What was that experience like?
It was cool, actually. Things were different with the way we did things with Saga. We always did things backwards, where we would write all the music first, and then the lyrics and melodies would go on afterwards.
Okay.
And when I went into the studio with Chris, he basically wrote me a synopsis of what each song was about.
Okay.
And I had a little cassette with actually just acoustic guitar demos.
Like a ghost track almost, right?
Yeah, almost. Okay. And he sort of encapsulated the mood that he wanted to create for each song.
Okay.
So he never told me what to play at all, which is cool. I mean, over the years, I don't think I've ever been handed a chart and somebody just goes, here, play this. Which is partly because being a drummer, it's most arrangers don't write drum charts, so that's very cool.
Okay. All right. Now, did you track that song? Way back remembering, Steve, testing the gray matter here again.
Yeah.
Did it take a day, less than a day, for Don't Pay the Ferryman? Do you remember? Because that's a pretty legendary tune. I'm really curious as to how long it took for you to actually, you know.
I think that one there, and again, this is, it's funny because we talked earlier about click tracks.
Sure.
And actually, John Giblin was the bass player on those sessions, who played with Simple Minds, Peter
sure.
Gabriel,
okay.
Kate Bush.
Whoa.
Phenomenal bass player.
Yes,
and
definitely.
And just impeccable timing. So I actually put a click track up for that song.
Sure.
And sent the engineers and everybody out for coffee, and I just had it in loop mode. So I could just play it over and over and experiment, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Then when I actually laid it down, because there's that whole section in the middle where it gets into all these voices and open the door and there's all this stuff.
Yeah.
Well, when we recorded that, there was nothing there because we're just laying the original tracks down. So it was just
sure.
bass, drums, and piano.
Okay.
So it was very sparse. So we had to basically count bars as we're getting through this whole section. And yeah, so it was almost like memory work. And they thought I was still listening to the click, but we had turned it off.
Okay.
But the timing was sitting so on it that they were checking to see that the click was still not plugged in, because I was right on the light for the whole song.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Now, do you remember what Chris's face looked like when he actually heard the final drums on it?
Well,
or did you see that? Or Rupert's, for example?
Well, it's a process that you're working on, and he was either playing acoustic guitar or piano at the time. So there is one interesting story with him.
Sure.
A song called To the Islands.
Okay.
And Chris is a typical singer-songwriter. he's not like a real band guy. See, band guys have this language of their own.
Okay.
When we talk about grooves and feels and chord changes and stuff like that, it's a musical language that a lot of guys, especially the blues guys, use all the time for basically communicating on stage. So if somebody doesn't know the song, they can still follow the changes.
Sure.
Chris doesn't do that. He's a singer-songwriter. So again, he's talking about moods and you know, coming at it from a totally different place. So with this song, To the Islands, I was putting Tim Lawley fills. I played a very simple groove through the whole song, just like a cross stick and bass drum, a little bit of hi-hat,
Okay. Which
threads the whole song. Then I was putting timbali overdubs in every possible hole. And Chris comes in and he goes, "Man, you guys are wrecking the tune. Man, you're putting all these drums on it, man." So
we
sent him down to the pub. Chris,
get a couple pints in you, Chris. Come back and we'll talk.
Come back in about an hour. We'll have this done. All right?
In other words, leave us alone.
Yeah. So Rupert and I, after we played in every possible place, then we go through and we see, okay, that one works. Let's take that one out, and you piece the whole thing together from what you've got, right?
Okay.
But there is the possibility of having this one or not this one, right? In every possible place. So you go through and then you pick the ones you want to keep.
Sure.
That's a fairly typical overdub thing to do, right? So Chris came back from the pub. Of course, he's had a couple of beers. He's playing the track, and he loves it. Man, it's great.
Thank God for Guinness. Now, wonderful. Now, Steve, you are not only an awesome drummer, you're also a producer, and you own a very nice private studio here in Hamilton.
Yeah.
Called Blue Room, right?
Yeah.
Is it still called the Blue Room?
It's called the Blue Room.
It's called the Blue Room. And you are now working with a band called Ivory. You're mixing the album, right?
That's true. I just finished mixing the album.
Now, can you tell us a little bit about Ivory? Give us a connection here so people know where they are from, what they're about, what the groove is, and then we'll play a track from them.
Okay. My parents used to have a house in Barbados.
Okay.
And I used to go down there. Actually, Nicole and I were married down there.
Yes.
On the beach. I have a bunch of musical friends down there that Ivory was actually one of the biggest bands on the island for a number of years.
Okay.
Back, quite a while back.
Okay.
And
would that be around the time when Saga was massive?
Yeah.
So the 80s?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And probably starting even back around the same time Saga started.
So okay, so 79. Yeah.
The 80s. We became good friends with Jimmy Duncan, who was the guitar player.
Okay.
And producer, basically, on this. They decided to get together. Frank Mossbaugh is the singer. He lives here in Toronto.
Okay.
Excuse me.
Excused.
He, basically, Jimmy came up and brought the tracks for his album. He asked me if I would mix it up here. I said I'd love to. So he brought it up, and it's 18 songs.
So wow.
It's quite an undertaking. It's taken me quite a while to mix all this stuff.
Now, actually, I heard it for the first time just a couple days ago. Nicole's birthday party was at your house, and we went down to the Blue Room, which I thought you weren't going to bring me down to the Blue Room, damn it. I was sitting there for like 3 or 4 hours, and I'm talking to Kelly Kerouac, and I'm like, well, Kel, is he actually going to take us into the Blue Room? And Kelly looks at me, who's Steve's new guitar player after Mark passed away.
Right.
And Kelly goes, we always go down to the
I just postponed it because, you know, because Nicole's birthday party.
Yeah,
you know?
So we didn't want to, like, poop all over Nicole, right?
That's right.
She's visiting with friends and whatnot, but we eventually got down to the Blue Room, which, by the way, was not my highlight of the evening, Nicole. Seeing you again was. And you played me this track, Sail On. Well, you played me several tracks, but the song is just incredible.
Yeah, the band did a really good job putting all these songs together in a very short period of time.
But you know what? It's not so much the band. The band, I mean, it's the mixer. It's the guy who mixes.
It's all about me. Yeah, it's all about me.
Well, no, I mean, you know, you can have a great tracking of an album, but if the thing isn't mixed and mastered properly, you might as well throw it in the garbage. Really?
Well, I agree, but there's the adage of polish a turd and it's still a turd, you know.
Well, it's true.
You got to have good stuff to
polish a turd. That's not a turd.
No,
this album is mint.
These guys did a great job, and I'm very happy that I had the opportunity to mix this stuff.
Okay, so let's play it.
Okay.
Here we go. Ivory, song called Sail On. Is this the first time ever on FM radio?
It is.
Oh, I'm so honored, Mr. Negus. Here we go.
A world premiere.
Band from Barbados with a Canadian connection. Steve Negus mixed this. Here is Sail On, Ivory. His wife Nicole is sitting right beside Steve, and she's on the BlackBerry or whatever she uses, and she's texting the lead vocalist who's happened to be driving right now.
Hi, Frank.
Very good. Now, you say 18 tracks on the album. When are we expecting this to be released officially, or has it been?
Well, it's just in the process of it, basically. We're putting together the, as I did with the Negus CD, limited edition.
Okay.
They're doing a limited edition, first of all, which is a really nice package.
Okay.
And then there will be the follow-up release to that. So, yeah, it's brand new. I mean, the CDs are still drying.
Ooh. Now, do you have an address for people to check out Ivory? Do you know off the top of your head, or do we just enter Ivory Barbados in Google would probably be the best thing to do, right?
That's it, yeah. I know they have some stuff set up, and I'm a little bit ill-prepared, and I don't have
it's
that
okay.
on hand.
So Ivory and then Barbados on Google, and you will hit the jackpot.
Absolutely.
On that one.
Yeah.
Okay, now is there a record deal for these guys, or is that the next step?
I think they're just doing an indie release.
Oh,
as
really?
As I know, but Frank did say something about a record label.
Okay. So there will be distribution, obviously, at some point on this.
Yeah, actually, I stand corrected or sit corrected on that one.
Okay.
Sometimes I'm not totally up to date on all the ins and outs because I'm too busy mixing.
Yeah, there to dream, there's Negus and Body and Soul. And we have the Body and Soul right in the studio here.
There we are.
The Lord of the Drums himself. Now, Steve, what kind of drums do you use now versus what you used then? You're a DW drummer now, aren't you?
I'm playing DWs at the moment, yeah. I was playing Ludwig for years. I played Gretsch at one point.
Simmons, obviously,
yeah. I have a Roland V drum kit that I used actually for the last part of the saga dates that I did.
Okay.
Excuse me. Which was actually a hybrid. I find that the weakest thing that the electronic kits do is the snare and cymbals.
Okay.
So I actually used an acoustic snare and real cymbals.
Okay.
And
that tailored tom sound that you have, right?
That's
you
know? It, yeah.
Now, these samples that you've loaded in the V-drum's brain, or are they samples that Roland's already provided you?
Well, I edit everything.
You do? So you mod it?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Now, talking about that electric acoustic sound, in the In Transit CD from 82, there's that solo, A Briefcase.
Yeah.
You're playing acoustic drums.
Yeah.
Frontman from Saga, Michael, is playing The Briefcase. And The Briefcase is exactly what it sounds like. It's a briefcase with, what, 7 pads in it?
That's right, yeah.
And Dave Simmons made that.
Dave Simmons.
For you.
And I understand that he only made about 14 of them.
Wow.
There's a Simmons website this guy in Germany has.
Okay.
And he's saying that Simmons actually only made about 14 of these briefcases. And I still have mine, which I'm actually going to sell through my Facebook page.
So that's interesting. Like, Steve, I had to ask you, why would you want to give up a piece of history like that? And I see that briefcase, and I've seen it a couple times at your place.
Yeah.
It's usually sitting downstairs in the basement kind of full.
It's sitting in a corner gathering dust.
What? Why wouldn't you donate that to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame is what I'm asking.
They can't have it. I'd rather...
There are reasons for that, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
See, okay. I've never really been much of a collector of musical stuff.
Memorabilia.
If it works for me, I'll keep it.
Okay.
If not, it has to go.
So it's part of what was.
Yes.
And
yeah.
You're moving on from that, right?
Forward thinking, and I'm sure somebody else, would be much happier to actually possess that thing.
Like about 50,000 Germans. Every German fan probably wants that briefcase.
Yeah, the magic for me was the moment when we used it. Now I'm not using it anymore, so the magic's gone, but the magic is still there for the people who experienced that.
Okay.
So it's much more precious for them than it is for me. So I'd rather see somebody like that have
it. Now, do you predict, are you going to sell it to somebody that isn't a drummer? Would you do that?
Of course.
So you'll sell it to anybody, depending on the price and whatnot, right?
Yeah, of course I'll sell it to anybody.
What is that thing worth?
We'll see.
Now, we're going to do something in HD video, maybe, over the next couple weeks or month.
Yeah.
With the briefcase, maybe, which might actually excite the bidding war a little bit.
We'll see what happens. Yeah.
Let's play the briefcase, and then we're actually going to stop, and we're going to talk about I Rest My Case, which is the
sequel.
Sequel to that 82 drum solo that so many stereo people across the world sold music to. I mean, like, I remember when I worked in the stereo shops in the 80s and stuff, put in the briefcase saga, right? And, you know, bing, 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 that receiver sold, that both systems sold. You know,
yeah, so
let's play. Here's a briefcase. It's recorded in 82. It's one of the first five CDs ever released.
Awesome.
And actually, I heard Nicole drumming through the microphones.
Sorry.
That was incredible.
Sorry.
You remember that night, right?
Yeah.
One of three nights or four nights that was tracked, right?
Oh, yeah. We did that every night, so.
Cool stuff. Now, when you actually, you sat down, and I remember us discussing this, well, 4 or 5 years ago, or 3 or 4 years ago, that you were going to do a sequel to that drum solo, because a lot of your European fans really could not get enough of that. So
yeah.
You came out with I Rest My Case.
That's right.
Now, Nicole, you actually videotaped him doing the first take of I Rest My Case.
That's right, yeah.
And you still have that.
That's right. We haven't done anything with it yet.
You're going to, though, I hope.
I definitely intend to, yeah.
Okay. Now, did you use that first solo as an inspiration for the second one at all, or is it just because it's another Negus solo? That's just Negus, not Saga Negus. I Rest My Case. This is so poignant, right?
Yeah, yeah. I don't think it started out. I mean, obviously, you draw on your past, but...
Sure.
I probably said to myself something like, self, you should probably put a drum solo on here. And the last time we did something like that, it was really cool to actually have more than one drummer.
Okay.
So... then I went, okay, well, I think what would be way more fun than just playing something.
Sure.
Sort of a musical masturbation session. it would make way more sense to have like a tribal thing where the groove builds and you have counterpoints. And it, for me, also being as a producer, it's way more interesting than just, you know, playing as fast as I can on by
yeah.
myself.
Okay.
I find that way more inspirational, and I really find it. I can do my best work when I've got something to work with.
Sure.
You know, music's a team sport. You know, and this is the tribal team, and even though I played a lot of the parts and I had other people play parts, it all fits together to make one thing. You know.
Now is this a song? This is an in-your-face solo too, right?
It is. This will blow your speakers up real good.
Now I hear this in the background during the beginning. Who is that? Is that you?
James Brown.
No, I hear it very faintly.
James Brown, I'm telling you.
What do you mean?
It's James Brown.
He's not gonna tell me, is he?
He's dead now, but he's on there.
What? Are you serious? No, he's not serious.
It's James Brown, I'm telling you.
Listen.
Let's see if you can spot it.
Okay. Negus, I Rest My Case. This is the sequel, more or less, to the legendary briefcase solo. Check this out, Indi 101. Now, there's a drum solo that you would need, what, about five drum kits on stage to replicate live?
Yeah, or at least one big one.
One big one, yes, one big one. In the whole, you know, I don't want to get to the secret of Steve Negus and the drumming, but how the hell did you come up with that? I mean,
It's all, it all just
starts. Is this something that plants in your head? Your...
Well, drummers are notorious noodlers.
Okay.
Right? Like, when you sit behind a set of drum kit, at any time, you can't not play it.
Okay.
That's a drummer thing, right? Sometimes it's really annoying. Especially, I mean, you see this all the time in the clubs with the new bands that are coming up. The drummer can't shut up.
Because yeah. I remember hearing that solo before the Tribe was added.
Yeah.
Like, you played that for me like 4 or 5 years ago, right?
That's
and
it.
Was like, and then you threw this tribal thing on there. It's like, I don't know whether to run to Africa and or grab a beer in Jamaica or something, but...
It all starts with a groove.
Yeah.
And the groove just came about by just something I was playing noodling.
Okay.
And it's quite an unusual groove. It's actually... I have this thing I like to do quite often. You play 3/4.
Sure.
A lot of musicians would get that, non-musicians wouldn't. But it's like a thing where it turns around. It's like da 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 da. But it's da 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 da.
You're talking Dutch to me, bro.
Right?
I think I know you.
It's a rhythm of 3 that fits over 4.
Okay.
Most music is in 4/4.
Okay.
Right? It's a nice little trick, and it turns itself around, and that whole piece is really based on 3/3 and 2 that make up the 8, as opposed to 4/4.
Okay.
Right? So it that's why it's got such a
new album. Can we talk about the working title or not? Or do you want to keep that?
Yeah, sure, we can talk about that.
Economy of Motion was what you threw at me the other night. And actually, you mentioned it about 6 months ago, too, as
yeah.
well. The title is just self-explanatory, isn't it?
It, really? It is to musicians. But
well,
it's
to me
funny.
It is, yeah.
Kelly Karelic, who is now my guitar player,
yeah.
He's an amazing player.
He's
one of the first guys that I actually came across who was hip to that.
The
concept itself, not just the title for the album, but the concept itself of economy of motion, because that's what him and I both do, and we both arrived at it separately. But
isn't that interesting, right? You kind of had the same idea.
Yeah, and that's really a key for being able to do sort of musical calisthenics, if you like. If you want to do anything that's really fast and intricate,
sure.
You have to almost choreograph your moves to set up the economy of motion. So if you want to get from here to here quickly, you do that, but you don't get from here to here quickly.
Okay.
Right? It's a motion thing, so you actually choreograph where you're going next, which makes things flow, and that's how you get the speed and the flow to it.
Now the timing... The drumming, the timing of the drumming on the new project, Economy of Motion, is different than
yes.
what you've drummed before.
Yeah.
It's even different from the Saga stuff, isn't it?
It is. We started to venture into that area a little bit on Generation 13.
Okay.
There's a 7 that I wrote for that one. But yeah, we're starting to get into time signatures again. It's more of a challenge, and, you know, just to play straight 4 can be, doesn't have to be, but can be a little bit mundane.
Wow.
So we need to up the ante. So I've been playing in 7s and 5s and still trying to have this body groove that makes it feel like it's music.
Sure. Now, you being... might I say in your 50s, if you don't mind me saying that, Steve?
You can say that.
Okay. And now you've actually stepped it up a bit. Well, not a bit, a lot. You're rehearsing, what, 3-4 hours a day now?
About 3 hours a day I play with my V-drum kit. Just put the headphones on, and I have a good workout, and I usually stop when the T-shirt's soaked down to the belt line.
Now, this is to prepare for the new album, right? It's all part of the inspiration of Economy of Motion, right?
I don't know if it necessarily even came out as consciously as being a part of the album. It's just something that I felt I was time for me to do.
Okay.
So it's hard. That's the you know, the horse before the cart kind of thing, which, you know, chicken or the egg. It's leading me in different places.
Okay.
And who really cares what motivated me to do it. The fact is, sure, I got motivated to do it.
So. Now, also, because the time signatures on the new work or the new music that you're working on is more aggressive.
Yes, yeah, I would say that.
So yeah, the stamina needs to be in place as well, which you've actually, I'd seen you drum the other night on the kit, and it was actually very sick. It was very, very good. And you know, I think a lot of people that are fans of yours, lifetime fans, are going to be extremely impressed by the new material. Did you bring any with you today?
I didn't.
It's still too early in the stages, folks. Steve's still working on it with it Kelly and Al and them. But there's a song, actually, Steve, from the Saga album Heads or Tails, The Pitchman.
Pitchman, yeah.
The Pitchman. I always say that wrong. I say Pitchman, you say Pitchman.
Well, it's actually just the inflection of the vocals, because it's Pitchman, Pitchman, right?
Now, I've interviewed you many times about, many things, but this is actually about a salesman, right?
This is it.
In England.
This is about actually somebody who wants to buy something and is talking to a salesman and going, come on.
Now, who's the Englishman? Who's the voice?
That's Rupert on there.
Rupert Hine.
That's Rupert Hine, yeah.
Interesting. Now, the actual groove of the tune has got your personality on it.
It does. It's got that sort of medieval.
This is back when you were still had creative control with Saga.
That's right. Yeah, it was shortly after that it went away.
So unfortunate. Let's play it, everybody. Here's Pitchman, Saga. I mean, these are still up and for sale, right? You can go to pretty well any record store in the English-speaking world and buy them, right? The Saga material, the older Saga material.
I'm sure you could download it free off the net, too.
Yeah.
Oops.
There's a long story behind that one, folks, that we are not going to get into on the air today. I guess, shall we say, Steve, we can touch on this briefly. You left the band for a reason.
Yes,
we'll
I did.
And we'll just leave it at that.
Yeah, I left for a reason, absolutely.
Yes, okay. Now, Steve and Nicole, who's sitting beside him, I want to thank you very much for coming in today. You are, without a doubt, my favorite drummer ever to come out of Canada, my
friend.
Well,
thank you.
You're a personal friend as well, so is your wife, Nicole. We're going to send the show off with one more Negus track off Dare to Dream. It's called One Man's Army.
Yeah.
Very cool. Al Langley on vocals. I wonder if Al's listening today, or if he's got his head shoved up Bon Journey or something.
He's probably
like
up in his cottage up north somewhere.
Yeah. Up north. Well, he's already in Thunder Bay. How much more up north can you get?
He's got a cottage north of Thunder Bay now.
Oh, God. What is it? You got like maybe a window of like 3 weeks where it's above 0 Celsius.
I know, but there's a lot of guitar brigades up there.
Interesting stuff. Now, gigs, you also play for Powerhouse, you play Chicago Transit, you play with the Rod Stewart Tribute Act as well, right?
That's true.
Is there stuff happening either with Negus or any of these other great bands in the next month? Can you spam us, Steve?
Live shows for Negus, not at the moment.
Okay.
No.
What about the Tribute Acts?
The Tribute stuff, I just played two nights in Brockville Wednesday, Thursday.
Okay.
That was actually with Frank Rondell, that's the Ray Charles Tribute.
Nice.
And Powerhouse backing them up and doing sort of R&B in Chicago.
Okay.
Yeah, that's another one of my ventures. It's all music and it's all good. It keeps me playing. And one day I'm out doing my original stuff. Next day I'm playing R&B.
Well, that's good, though. It's all about the groove, right?
It's all about playing music.
Now, Steve, I just want to ask you one other question. Prog drummers are prog drummers, but most prog drummers don't really pay attention to the meticulous use of the hi-hat, which you are very well known as.
Yeah,
a drummer that
be known for my hi-hat playing, which I think stems naturally from all the R&B stuff.
Yeah.
You know, I think if you listen to Dave Garibaldi from Tower of Power,
okay,
or the guys, the Clyde Stubblefields, the guy, Bernard Purdy, the guys who played with James Brown.
Okay.
They were hi-hat guys.
Yeah.
You know, and that's...
It makes the music more interesting, too, doesn't it? It's much more stimulating.
Yeah, it's much more articulate,
yeah,
too. You know, it's well-defined. Hi-hat is really your timekeeper. And, and I find a lot of guys, too, they play it too high, so they end up playing with the shaft of the stick as opposed to the tips.
Yeah, where you get that...
Yeah, so you don't get that nice crisp, but especially when you're doing 16ths, you get kind of this washy thing. So
yeah, imagine what Don't Be Late would have been like without that hi-hat roll at the beginning.
Oh yeah. I mean, I used to play that and the audience would know immediately what's
as soon as
identifiable as that song.
Two beats it, right?
That's,
you know,
it.
People would know.
Yeah.
All right, well, Steve, thanks for coming in. We're going to play one more song from the Dare to Dream album. It's called One Man's Army. You can go to stevenegus.com or just enter Steve Negus on Google and there will be like 100,000 pages of him.
Yeah, or it'll be up on Facebook.
Facebook as well, yeah. You actually have the band page and a personal page as well, right?
That's right, yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much, Steve, for coming.